Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Red Menace. On this month's episode, we are covering the Communist Manifesto by Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels. And as such, Allison and I discussed it a little bit, and we wanted to kind of step back from our normal structure, our sort of three-part structure when we're tackling a text, and sort of have still a robust summary up front, perhaps, but more of a loosely structured, organic conversation around the text as a whole, because as a manifesto, it's not necessarily a work of deep political theory, although obviously there's lots of theory in here, but it's in a more summarized form. So it will be a sort of diversion from our normal strict structure when we're tackling text, but I don't think that should take away from this discussion at all. If anything, I think it'll add to it, given the nature of what this text is and how it differs from other works of political theory. But let's begin with a summary of the text itself. Allison, take it away.
All right. So starting off with the first chapter. So this chapter opens, and really the book proper opens, with the famous line, quote, "The history of all hitherto existing societies is the history of class struggle." And Marx argues that in all great societies, class struggle has been a defining characteristic. He writes that, quote, "Freeman and slave, patrician and plebeian, lord and serf, guild master and journeyman, in a word, oppressor and oppressed, stood in constant opposition to one another, carried an uninterrupted, now hidden, now open fight. A fight that each time ended either in a revolutionary reconstruction of society at large or in the common ruin of the contending classes," end quote. In our modern society, according to Marx, things have simplified down largely to the conflict between the proletarian workers and the bourgeois capitalists. Marx provides a basic sort of historical sketch of the development of these conditions, explaining that the bourgeoisie first emerged from, quote, "the ruins of feudal society," end quote, and emerged specifically from the well-off town-dwelling burghers, who themselves had emerged from the earlier class of serfs. The burghers themselves had been town dwellers in the Middle Ages who had certain social and political privileges, placing them above the rest of non-noble peoples. So Marx explains that as exploitation continued and Europe began to develop intensifying global trade connections, the need for more direct and productive forms of manufacturing increased as well, leading to the doing away of the old guild system of production and the development of a middle class of manufacturers. And this all eventually led to the opening up of a global world market. This market led to, quote, "an immense development to commerce, to navigation, to communication by land. This development has, in its turn, reacted on the extension of industry in proportion as industry, commerce, navigation, railways extended, in the same proportion the bourgeoisie developed, increased its capital, and pushed into the background every class handed down from the Middle Ages," end quote. So based on that very basic historical trajectory of the development of the bourgeoisie, Marx points out that it's clear that the bourgeoisie themselves have not always existed, but rather came to prominence through varying historical factors, as well as through revolutions of their own, both in terms of industry and politics. So Marx takes pain to point out that in this regard, the bourgeoisie has historically operated as a revolutionary class in its own right, tearing apart feudal relationships, creating new revolutionary forms of government for its time, overthrowing monarchies, etc. The bourgeoisie is thus, in Marx's view, a class which has utterly transformed the world during its ascendancy. And even once the bourgeoisie has come to power, they still continue to transform the world. Marx notes that the bourgeoisie has to constantly renovate the means of production. New technology is constantly sought after, as the bourgeoisie always seeks greater productivity and greater profits. This constant need for technological and industrial revolution has created a situation in which change is a constant factor. Marx thus summarizes, "constant revolutionizing of production, uninterrupted disturbance of all social conditions, everlasting uncertainty and agitation distinguish the bourgeois epoch from all earlier ones. All fixed, frozen relations with their train of ancient and venerable prejudices and opinions are swept away. All new formed ones become antiquated before they can ossify," end quote. So all of this has been accompanied by a constant expanding of global markets, which has blurred national distinctions and led to an increasingly global world, according to Marx. Furthermore, the bourgeoisie has also created a situation in which cities have grown out of towns and have become the central dominant form of life dominating the countryside. Thus, Marx does a very solid job of historicizing the bourgeoisie in a way that shows that not only has the capitalist class not always existed, but rather in a way that goes further to demonstrate that the capitalist class was itself a product of revolutionary change. The rise of the bourgeoisie was itself a rebellion against feudal conditions and society which had birthed the class itself. So thus, Marx summarizes this historicization by writing, quote, "We see then the means of production and of exchange on whose foundation the bourgeoisie built itself up were generated in feudal society. At a certain stage in the development of these means of production and of exchange, the conditions under which feudal society produced and exchanged, the feudal organization of agriculture and manufacturing industry, in one word, the feudal relations of property, became no longer compatible with the already developed productive forces. They became so many fetters. They had to be burst asunder, and they were burst asunder. Into their place stepped free competition, accompanied by social and political constitution, adapted in it and the economic and political sway of the bourgeois class," end quote. So, while the bourgeoisie represents the result of many successful revolutionary developments themselves, they also face many forms of crises that arise from the conditions of capitalism. So Marx notes a few forms of these crises, paying specific attention to the occasional crisis of overproduction, which destabilizes markets and threatens the stability of bourgeois rule. And the anarchy of the markets themselves and the general instability which characterizes capitalist society then creates constant crises which threaten the bourgeoisie. So Marx summarizes, quote, "The productive forces at the disposal of society no longer tend to further the development of the conditions of bourgeois property. On the contrary, they have become too powerful for these conditions, by which they are fettered. And so soon as they overcome these fetters, they bring disorder into the whole of bourgeois society, endangering the existence of bourgeois property," end quote. So bourgeois rule is thus threatened, according to Marx, not only by the crisis endemic to capitalist production, but also by another class which the bourgeoisie has brought into existence, the proletariat, as Marx calls them, a class of laborers who live only so long as they find work, and who find work only so long as their labor increases capital. So this is the proletariat who must sell their labor to survive. And this class of laborers is entirely disenchanted with the labor they perform, according to Marx, because the use of machinery, which has taken the art out of production, along with the division of labor in modern industrial production, has created general alienation from labor. Marx explains that the worker has become, quote, "an appendage of the machine, and it is only the most simple, most monotonous, and most easily acquired knack that is required of him," end quote. These workers live a difficult life, working for an insufficient wage, paid to them by the bourgeois factory owners. They find themselves then paying back this wage to the bourgeoisie in the form of rent and expenditure for survival. Meanwhile, the middle class find themselves slowly being transformed into proletarians, and thus the ranks of the proletariat grow. In the age of industrial production, the proletariat begins to grow to a sizable class that has real strength, if only on the basis of its numbers. Mechanical developments has made life more and more precarious for the proletariat, and clashes between the proletariat and the bourgeoisie begin to develop and take place rather openly. And over time, this conflict both increases in intensity and frequency, largely driven by the fact that the proletariat is constantly growing in size, as even aristocratic holdovers from the feudal era, as well as some members of the ruling class themselves, are threatened with proletarianization and financial ruin. Marx then writes, quote, "Finally, in times when the class struggle nears the decisive hour, the progress of disillusion going on within the ruling class, in fact within the whole range of old society, assumes such a violent, glaring character that a small section of the ruling class cuts itself adrift and joins the revolutionary class, the class that holds the future in its hands. Just as therefore, at an earlier period, a section of the nobility went over to the bourgeoisie, so now a portion of the bourgeoisie goes over to the proletariat, and in particular, a portion of the bourgeois ideologists who have raised themselves to the level of comprehending theoretically the historical movement as a whole. Of all the classes that stand face to face with bourgeois society today, the proletariat alone is a really revolutionary class. The other classes decay and finally disappear in the face of modern industry. The proletariat is itself special and essential product," end quote. And so thus, the instability within capitalism, both resulting from constant crisis as well as a growing and angry proletariat, ensure that eventually there will be a point of rupture, according to Marx. And Marx finally summarizes his position, writing, quote, "The essential condition of the existence and for the sway of the bourgeois class is the formation and augmentation of capital. The condition for capital is wage labor. Wage labor rests exclusively on competition between the laborers. The advance of industry, whose involuntary promoter is the bourgeoisie, replaces the isolation of the laborer due to competition by revolutionary combination due to association. The development of modern industry, therefore, cuts from under its feet the very foundations on which the bourgeoisie produces and appropriates products. What the bourgeoisie therefore produces, above all, are its own grave diggers. Its fall and victory of the proletariat are equally inevitable.
Okay, so for what amounts to chapter two, I'll be covering that, and it is entitled Proletarians and Communists. And there's three main things that Marx and Engels seek to accomplish in this chapter, chapter two. The first one is talking about the relationship between communists and proletarians, or the working class, what that relationship might look like, what the job of the communist is as the most advanced sort of cutting edge, they call the most advanced and resolute section of the working class. And then they move on to a sort of back and forth between some common arguments against communism of their time and their rebuttals. What's fascinating about that is that so many of the ideological arguments marshaled against communism still exist today. So it's just, again, another fascinating tracing of things that are relevant in their time and are still relevant now. And then they end this section with talking, actually, to my surprise, because I hadn't read this text in for so long, some of a bit of a framework of what a socialist transition might look like. So starting from the first basic argument, which is the communists' relationship to workers, I'll read a little bit from the text. In what relation do the communists stand to the proletarians as a whole? The communists do not form a separate party opposed to other working class parties. They have no interests separate and apart from those of the proletariat as a whole. They do not set up any sectarian principles of their own by which to shape and mold the proletarian movement. The communists are distinguished from the other working class parties by this only. One, in the national struggles of the proletarians of the different countries, they point out and bring to the front the common interests of the entire proletariat, independent of all nationality, i.e., proletarian internationalism. And two, in the various stages of development which the struggle of the working class against the bourgeoisie has to pass through, they always and everywhere represent the interests of the movement as a whole. So, sort of robust defense of proletarian interests, no matter what area or space that they're working in. And the text goes on, just for one more paragraph that I want to highlight here. The communists, therefore, are on the one hand practically the most advanced and resolute section of the working class parties of every country, that section which pushes forward all others. On the other hand, theoretically, they have over the great mass of the proletariat the advantage of clearly understanding the line of march, the conditions, and the ultimate general results of the proletarian movement, i.e. historical materialism. The immediate aim of the communists is the same as that of all other proletarian parties: formation of the proletariat into a class, overthrow of the bourgeois supremacy, conquest of political power by the proletariat. In this sense, the theory of the communists may be summed up in the single sentence, abolition of private property. So I jumped around a little bit there, but you get the basic idea. To bring this analysis to the workers, to advocate for the proletariat in every arena, to push this proletarian internationalist line, which pushes against and hedges against nationalism, and to create the conditions for the formation of the proletariat into a self-conscious class that can take on and confront the bourgeoisie. And then the second part is, again, where they go through a sort of bunch of arguments surrounding private versus personal property, which is an interesting distinction made here in the Communist Manifesto, a sort of dismantling of the bourgeois conception of freedom. And I'll read this little line, which is very famous, and you've probably heard of it even if you hadn't read the text or at least part of it. But I really love what this line gets at specifically with relation to private property and the bourgeois notion of freedom. It goes as quoted, "You are horrified at our intending to do away with private property. But in your existing society, private property is already done away with for 9/10 of the population. Its existence for the few is solely due to its non-existence in the hands of those 9/10. You reproach us, therefore, with intending to do away with a form of property, the necessary condition for whose existence is the non-existence of any property for the immense majority of society. In one word, you reproach us with intending to do away with your property. Precisely so. That is just what we intend. That's just a wonderful summing up of the communist commitment to the abolition of private property and the simultaneous dismantling of the idea that property is something that everybody has access to when, you know, and its relation to freedom, when in fact it is so thoroughly in the hands of the bourgeoisie by definition that for most of us we have no property. You know, we have jobs, we have landlords, we don't own the means of production, a lot of us don't own our homes. And so that point is just beautifully articulated right there. And then they go on to talk about objections to communism based on it will make us universally lazy. We've all heard that. The idea that capitalism is a form of human nature and just a manifestation of human reason with the capital R. Talk about the family and education, which we get into here in a bit in the second section of this discussion with Allison. It talks about women, nationalism, consciousness and ideas. Quote, when people speak of ideas that revolutionize society, they do but express the fact that within the old society, the elements of a new one have been created, and that the dissolution of the old ideas keeps even pace with the dissolution of the old conditions of existence. Again, tying in people's consciousness and their ideas about the world to the material conditions from which they and their ideas arise, which is, you know, a core facet of historical materialism. And then they move on to talking about, in so many terms, what a socialist transition might look like. And this is really interesting because in most other Marxist works, Marx and Engels, they tend to, you know, and rightfully so, stay away from predictions for the most part. And this can lead, I think, to a lot of sort of distortions of Marxism and taking Marxism in ways that are explicitly anti-Marxist, like the reformist route, for example. But they say here, quote, the proletariat will use its political supremacy to wrest by degrees all capital from the bourgeoisie, to centralize all instruments of production in the hands of the state, i.e. of the proletariat organized as the ruling class, and to increase the total of productive forces as rapidly as possible. So when they say the proletariat will use its political supremacy in the form of the proletarian state to wrest by degrees all capital from the bourgeoisie, I think what they're gesturing towards is this need for the socialist transition. That communism does not come out of capitalism, but there is a protracted historical process bridging those two modes of production and relations of production, and that is what we call socialism. And so the emphasizing of by degrees really talks about this idea that you can't get everything overnight, that the socialist transition will require these movements that are sort of strategic and one at a time, and it is a protracted process. But you know, they talk also about centralizing the instruments of production in the hands of the state. This is something that anybody who identifies, as I used to, with some form of libertarian Marxism really is just a betrayal of Marxism if you think that the state a priori never has a role to play in a socialist transition. Now, in the intro, which we read the intro and the full text in the Patreon episode, so if you want to actually hear us read all this, you can go check that out. But in the intro, Marx does talk about how the Paris Commune slightly tweaked his language here, and that's when he brings up, as he did in the Civil War in France, that you cannot merely lay hands on the ready-made machinery of the state, which is a nuance that didn't fully get addressed in this quote, but is important. And then they go to lay out, let's see here, the 10 things, 10 policies that a socialist transition might include. Now, I will read these, but again, in the intro, Marx makes it very clear that these 10 commands were very much in the historical moment that they were writing this. And in the 25 years since, this might have changed. So he does say that this is a general sort of gesturing towards what a communist policy might look like, but that it's always going to be dependent on the material conditions of any given society, of any given historical moment, etc. So don't take these as like hard and fast rules that you start implementing right away, but just as some vague outlines for where they were at their time and what might have been something like a framework for a socialist transition and its policies. But I will go through them just because they're interesting and they're worth noting. 1. Abolition of property in land and application of all rents of land to public purposes. 2, a heavy progressive or graduated income tax. 3, abolition of all rights of inheritance. 4, confiscation of the property of all emigrants and counter-revolutionaries, people fleeing the revolution, people fighting against the revolution, etc. Centralization of credit in the hands of the state by means of a nationalized banking system with state capital and an exclusive monopoly. So really taking finance out of the hands of capital and into the hands of the people. 6, centralization of the means of communication and transport in the hands of the state. 7, extension of factories and instruments of production owned by the state, the bringing into cultivation of wastelands, and the improvement of the soil generally in accordance with a common plan. So here you see them hinting at something like an eco-Marxist environmentalist sort of conception of a socialist transition where you're taking into account the health of the natural environment. 8, equal liability of all to labor. Basically, jobs guarantee everybody can have a job. Nobody's going to go without. Nobody's going to be unemployed, etc. Combination of agriculture with manufacturing industries. The gradual abolition of the distinction between town and country by a more equitable distribution of the population over the country. That's really interesting. It speaks to Marxist versions of geography. I think David Harvey is a good representative of this mode of thought, where you're actually now thinking about, as they say, an equitable distribution of the population over the country, an abolition of the distinction between rural countrysides and cities. How that would play out, what that would look like, I don't know, but it's a very interesting conception, particularly tied in with an environmentalist understanding of Marxism because of how intensive city centers can be. And, you know, there's a whole process of primitive accumulation and forcing people from the countryside into the cities, stripping them of their autonomy and their land ownership is all part of a big process of capitalism getting started and continuing. So thinking about what the geography of territories and land and the distribution of people would look like in a socialist or communist context is fascinating and worth thinking about. And then finally, number 10, free education for all children in public schools, the abolition of children's factory labor, which is obvious, interesting. Universal education is essential. It's always been part and parcel with a socialist revolutions, literacy rates, making sure that poor children and working children have good education and access to universal education, etc. So those are just some ideas. A lot of those things would still very much be relevant. Some of those things would be tweaked based on where you're at and what the conditions you're operating in are. But it's just an interesting sort of gesturing towards what those policies could look like and some main things that were in Marx and Engels' mind with regards to how to start moving toward communism in the midst of a socialist transition. And then they also talk about, I guess, what would eventually be the withering away of the state when they say, quote, when in the course of development, class distinctions have disappeared and all production has been concentrated in the hands of a vast association of the whole nation, the public power will lose its political character. And you can go to our episode on Lenin State and Revolution if you want to hear more about that idea. They end this chapter by saying, quote, in place of the old bourgeois society with its classes and class antagonisms, we shall have an association in which the free development of each is the condition for the free development of all. A worthy idea. Allison?
In this chapter, Marx looks at the development of socialist and communist literature from the various movements that produced it in order to explain what other approaches to communism have looked like and offer some criticism of them. So he begins this process by examining reactionary forms of socialism first. And the first form of reactionary socialism that Marx examines is feudal socialism. And Marx has already established in previous chapters the rise of bourgeoisie required the dispossession of the aristocratic class as the young bourgeoisie overthrew the relations of feudal society. The French Revolution, for example, devastated the aristocratic classes and, according to Marx, made it clear to them that they could not engage in full-on political conflict with the bourgeoisie. Marx argues that the aristocracy thus appealed to the working class and developed a strange sort of reactionary socialism, through which they aired their grievances against the bourgeoisie while using the workers as a sort of proxy. So despite vague and general appeals to the working class, this form of socialism is still reactionary at its core, according to Marx, based on an actual hatred of the working class in many ways, and often willing to profit from capitalism whenever it gets the chance. So Marx explains, quote, "In pointing out that their mode of exploitation was different from the bourgeoisie, the feudalists forget that they exploited under circumstances and conditions that were quite different, that are now quite antiquated. In showing that, under their rule, the modern proletariat never existed, they forget that the modern bourgeoisie is necessary offspring of their own form of society. For the rest, so little do they conceal the reactionary character of their criticism that their chief accusation against the bourgeoisie amounts to this, that under the bourgeois regime, a class is being developed which is destined to cut up the root and branch of the old society. What they upbraid the bourgeoisie with is not so much that it creates a proletariat as that it creates a revolutionary proletariat." End quote. So Marx, after looking at the feudal socialists, turns to an examination of petty bourgeois socialism. So he explains that although the bourgeoisie emerged from the medieval burghers, in some countries which developed more slowly, the burghers continued to exist as a class even while a distinct bourgeoisie emerged, leading to the development of a stunted petty bourgeoisie, quote, "fluctuating between proletariat and bourgeoisie," end quote. This petty bourgeoisie are constantly at risk of falling into the proletariat, and they thus resent the big bourgeoisie. This led to a petty bourgeois socialism that in theory advanced the interests of the petty bourgeoisie along with those of the peasants and the proletariat. Marx recognizes the important insights of this form of socialism, writing that, quote, "This school of socialism dissected with great acuteness the contradictions and the conditions of modern production. It laid bare the hypothetical apologies of economists. It proved incontrovertibly the disastrous effect of machinery and division of labor, the concentration of capital and land in a few hands, overproduction and crisis. It pointed out the inevitable ruin of the petty bourgeoisie and the peasant, the misery of the proletariat, the anarchy and production, and the crying inequalities in the distribution of wealth," end quote. Ultimately, however, Marx argues that this form of socialism puts forward a reactionary aim inasmuch as its main focus is on returning to the previous form of society and production. It does not seek to advance beyond capitalism, but rather to return to a time before it. So in addition to looking towards examples of reactionary socialism, Marx also examines what he calls conservative or bourgeois socialism, which emerged from the portion of the capitalist class which is, quote, "desirous of redressing social grievances in order to secure the continued existence of bourgeois society," end quote. This form of socialism is primarily an expression of the bourgeoisie's own anxiety regarding social instability and is fixated on creating a more stable society in which the proletariat do not pose a threat to the bourgeoisie and can be altogether forgotten. It often takes an interest in promoting state reforms, which leave the material relations between workers and the capitalists totally intact, and it fails to address the actual conditions which produce instability and suffering. So then finally, Marx turns towards an examination of what he calls critical utopian socialism and communism. And he sees this as a socialism that is still grounded in the struggle between classes, theorized by people like Saint-Simon, Fourier, and Owen. And these people began to develop their own views of socialism that were grounded in actual class antagonisms. They unfortunately, however, according to Marx, do not develop a truly proletarian form of socialism. They ultimately see little hope of the conditions of capitalism itself to allow for the proletarian liberation, and they turn towards utopianism. Marx explains that, quote, "since the development of class antagonisms keeps even pace with the development of industry, the economic situation as they find it does not as yet offer them the material conditions for the emancipation of the proletariat. They therefore search for a new social science, after new social laws, to create these conditions. Historical action is to yield to their personal inventive action, historically created conditions of emancipation to fantastic ones," end quote. And so for these socialists, they're not looking to the way that capitalism's own internal contradictions are going to lead to the collapse of capitalism through the proletariat. They rather are trying to come up with these utopian forms of socialism. And Marx in some ways attributes this to them writing during the earlier phase of capitalism, rather than to some sort of, you know, distinct philosophical error that they've made. So, this leads to them developing strategies for the peaceful development of socialism and imagining utopian future societies that emerge not from the struggle of the workers, but from some utopian reimagining of society. But despite these limits, Marx still says that there is sort of a crucial critical element within this literature, which does accurately critique much of the conditions of capitalism. And thus, these thinkers do have an important role in the liberation of the proletariat. Even though they do have some value, though, they ultimately oppose all political action by the proletariat as a class, and thus they remain very limited in their utility. And so Marx finishes his assessment of socialist literature.
All right, chapter 4, and the final chapter is only about a page and a half long, and it is titled Position of the Communists in Relation to the Various Existing Opposition Parties. And what this basically is just a quick sort of summary of how communists should navigate politics generally, how they should relate to, let's say, different parties strategically, maybe liberal parties or aligning with certain formations who have shared interest for a time, but, you know, never taking their eye off the ball, never failing to promote the interest of the proletariat, always engaging strategically, but never betraying the core values of communism. And since this is so short and there's, I mean, very little to sort of summarize, I'll just read a big chunk of this final, basically, couple of paragraphs for people just so they can get an idea of how this text sort of wraps itself up. Communists never cease for a single instant to instill into the working class the clearest possible recognition of the hostile antagonism between bourgeoisie and proletariat, in order that the German workers may straightaway use, as so many weapons against the bourgeoisie, the social and political conditions that the bourgeoisie must necessarily introduce along with its supremacy, and in order that, after the fall of the reactionary classes in Germany, the fight against the bourgeoisie itself may immediately begin. In short, the communists everywhere support every revolutionary movement against the existing social and political order of things. In all these movements, they must bring to the front, as the leading question in each, the property question, no matter what its degree of development is at that time. Finally, they labor everywhere for the union and agreement of the democratic parties of all countries. The communists disdain to conceal their views and aims. They openly declare that their ends can be attained only by the forcible overthrow of all existing social conditions. Let the ruling classes tremble at a communistic revolution. The proletarians have nothing to lose but their chains. They have a world to win. So yeah, I'm really excited. I haven't read this work in, I think over 12, 13, 14 years. I think the first text of communist political theory I ever read was the Communist Manifesto at age, I think, like 16 or 17. I think I've talked about this before on the show where it was sort of incomprehensible to me, but a few like lines stuck out, and I started taking communism seriously, and it put me on a long, protracted road, I think, to eventually becoming a communist, because the talk of working class stuff, specifically jargon and historical references, which I did not get aside, the obvious discussion of working class and setting it up against the capitalist class made a fuck ton of sense to me as a 17-year-old working class kid. And I think that's what stuck with me, what showed me, what gave me interest in Marxism and put me on that road. But coming back as a 31-year-old with a lot more political understanding, it was just really interesting to see how I engage with the text so much differently and how I understand it on so many different levels than I did that first time. So yeah, maybe that's a good place to start, Allison, as to what your overall thoughts are on this text, when you were introduced to it, if you'd read it before, and how that's different from you reading it now, etc.
Yeah, so that actually is where I had hoped to start anyway, so that works out really well. So yeah, when I had first read this text, God, it would have been years ago, at least 5, maybe more, I picked it up and I had a very similar experience of how I was like, I don't know what this is saying. I think like many people, I picked it up and I was like, oh, here's what I'm going to find out, like what a communist society looks like and what a communist country is supposed to look like and the things that the communists are trying to build. And weirdly enough, if that's what you want from this text, you're not going to get very much. There's a little discussion of those things, but the text, you know, obviously does a lot more. It talks about historical literature around socialism and communism. It gives a historical tracing of the emergence of the capitalist class. It's very actually strange in a lot of ways that, you know, from a modern understanding of what we would take a manifesto to mean, this often does not read like a manifesto, I think, in a way that can be tricky. So when I first read the text, I was very perplexed and confused by it, and I largely did not know what to make of it. But as I eventually, you know, took took time to study sort of Marxism more broadly, and this text more specifically, I eventually started to understand, like, oh, this is explaining historical materialism. You know, it's not giving, like, a clear political program, although there is some political program in it. It is also explaining, like, the philosophical underpinning of the communist position. And I think in that sense, the text is really tricky because I think for a lot of people, they think, I want to learn about communism, and this is the text they pick up, right? And it might not actually be the best introduction in some ways to that, you know? I always tell people that for Marx and Engels, Engels' Principles of Communism is like a much clearer starting point that explains things in a more clear way than this text. And I think, you know, when I think of this text, you know, being difficult in that way, I often think of the debate between Jordan Peterson and Zizek, where all the research that Peterson did for that debate was to read this text, essentially, which will give you an understanding of some of Marxism, but certainly will not give you a comprehensive understanding of it. So the Manifesto is this interesting text, in my opinion, because it gets treated as potentially an introductory text to the topic, but it's not very good as an introductory text, in my opinion. And people often, I think, approach it and come away without very much because they don't have the context to understand it to a certain extent.
Exactly. And it's funny that you already jumped on that because we took our notes separately and I was going to ask that as the first question. Like, would you recommend this as a first text to someone getting into communism? Because I actually had a friend reach out when I said that we were going to do this for Red Menace. And they said basically what you said, which is that he pointed out that reactionaries, conservatives, etc., if they read any Marxism at all, it's almost only and exclusively this. Which gives rise to a bunch of different weird things, perhaps. And I think that Zizek and Peterson debate really shows how this is insufficient if you want a robust understanding of Marxism, because Peterson got his ass kicked in that debate and just sort of exposed for the charlatan he is as somebody who makes money and builds a huge sort of persona off, you know, neo-postmodern Marxist, you know, critiques or whatever, but has no clue about the words that are actually what they actually mean in that context, which I think is interesting. This text is sort of, it has pros and cons as an introductory text, because in some sense it is a really nice sort of summary of some really main points inherent in Marxism. But I think Allison's right that you really need that broader context and understanding coming to the text to get the most out of it. And I think our early engagements with the text, specifically mine when I was literally just a teenager with no understanding at all of Marxism, I think it highlights that sort of pitfall. Like, you know, it can be sort of incomprehensible to you if you don't have that broader context already. And then another thing, just because this is a broader discussion about recommending texts for people who want to get into socialism and communism, which is something probably any of us have dealt with, people asking us, you know, where do I start, etc. And I just think it's worth pointing out that I get this question a lot, obviously, and I do my best, right, especially like strangers online that I don't know personally, like, where do I start? Well, I'll give them some basic ideas, but I think what's really important when it comes to recommending a text to somebody is knowing them individually, knowing what their understanding already is, knowing where their already existing interests lie, and then playing on those two things. And so if I'm trying to get my grandfather into socialist theory, it's going to be a much different introductory set of texts than if I'm getting, you know, an 18-year-old black working class person into it. And if I'm getting my co-worker on the line at the pizza joint into Marxism, it's going to be different than if I'm getting my fellow philosophy grad student into Marxism. And so I really think while trying to come up with some general first text is good, and sometimes it's all you can do, I think if you really want to make an impact and get people into it, knowing them on the individual level and giving them something that already hits on already existing interests and understandings is more important than some one-size-fits-all recommendation.
Yeah, no, I strongly agree. And this is a text that I think, like, for someone who already knows a little bit of the history, you know, would be a little more useful because they might have some context for it. And again, this text does give, like, a very, like, good basic summary of the dialectical view of history, of what class struggle is. It just sort of, I think, is often not enough on its own without some secondary explanation. And I think that part of what it comes down to, too, is like when we recommend texts to people, it's not always sufficient to recommend just primary texts, right? Sometimes secondary literature or things like we're trying to do with this podcast can be helpful in terms of trying to contextualize things, because it can be a little bit tricky to approach a text that comes from a historical period you might not know a lot about and try to untangle what's going on on in it. You know, Marx here is referring to a whole bunch of different theorists and philosophers and different movements. And, you know, a person who knows nothing about the socialist tradition is not going to have the context for that. And that obviously makes things a little bit more difficult, I think. So, you know, it's one of those things where when we're recommending things to people, I think providing resources beyond the text itself is just always very important as well.
Absolutely. Where do you want to go next on this discussion? There's a lot of different routes we could take, I guess.
Yeah, so one thing I wanted to talk about with this that I like about this text a lot that I think is really interesting is sort of there's two aspects that I think are really cool. One is, like, aside from giving an introduction to sort of the history of the development of capitalism and to Marxist views on it, I really like that this text, more than in a lot of Marx's other popular works, really hits on the fact that the bourgeoisie was a revolutionary class in a lot of ways. You know, it's a thing that people forget, right? And I think that's important to remember. Not because that's a reason we should, like, valorize the bourgeoisie or overemphasize, like, the progressive aspects of the rise of the bourgeoisie, which Marx does touch on here, but because it tells us that capitalism isn't eternal. Right? That's what I think is so valuable about this text in a lot of ways, is that Marx is quite simply, in the first chapter especially, just saying, this is where capitalism came from. It's easy to see. It's right there. It overthrew relations that came before it and has not always been here. It is, in fact, something that emerged from struggle itself. And I think that's just kind of a historicization that is really powerful that Marxism has, that pushes back against a lot of kind of liberal hegemony about the idea of capitalism being natural and eternal. And that's something that I think you see throughout this text, as Marx looks at the way, you know, even in later chapters, that the bourgeoisie upended family relations and all these other things. He's really emphasizing how much of a revolution the development of capitalism was. And I think that's a very, very useful insight for being able to explain to people why capitalism is probably not the end of history.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with that. It's a great point. And it's also just an essential showcasing of historical and dialectical materialism, wherein, you know, understanding the world is not broken into simple categories of good and bad, but it shows how capitalism's seeds were already present in the feudal order, and how in that context the rising bourgeoisie were a revolutionary force. And in that same way, you can look at late capitalism right now, seeing the progressive seeds and the revolutionary seeds being brought to fruition through the process of capitalism unfolding, and that is the socialist communist element. And so understanding it in the feudal context is really important to understanding it now and helps clarify a lot of things. And then especially in my debates with, like, reactionaries or libertarians or conservatives or just people who really believe in capitalism, they really do think of it as a sort of end-all be-all of political and economic systems, mm-hmm. and they defend it as such. They can't really even comprehend that it is historically contingent, or that it will, it's ephemeral in the way that all past societies are. And even without even getting into the depths of historical materialism, pointing out that capitalism came from feudalism and that all these other, you know, systems existed before capitalism is a really great way to sort of start to dismantle the argument and the implicit bias underneath a lot of arguments from that side, which does sort of presume a sort of that capitalism is natural, that it just is. This is sort of a side tangent, but a related part of this is how people who defend capitalism will often reduce it to, like, very simple things that exist through all humanity. A big thing is, like, trade. Like, you know, capitalism right. is just trade, or capitalism is just how prices are set, etc. And expanding that and forcing people to confront it as a protracted historical process that was birthed out of another one and that is historically contingent and ultimately ephemeral as societies continue to evolve, I think is just really a paradigm shift for anybody who is actually acting in good faith and wants to understand this stuff. And so, I don't know, that might be helpful to people, regardless of what you're talking to, maybe a new lefty who's trying to understand this stuff or trying to defend communism and socialism against pro-capitalists, libertarians, reactionaries, etc. I think that can be helpful.
Yeah, it definitely pushes back against those reductive definitions of capitalism as just trade or whatever in a really useful way. And I think, like, yeah, it is interesting that we do see here, like, a very succinct definition of what capitalism is, according to Marx, which goes against those sort of ideological interpretations of it. And so it's definitely something that I think is very valuable about it and still gives it continued propagandistic value. You know, I've maybe pushed back a little bit on this text as an introduction, but there is still some really basic stuff in here that's really useful. Are there any other things that you sort of had observations on about the text on the whole?
Yeah, I have a few points to make. I'll throw out one that maybe will be interesting. And this actually comes from the intros, which I actually really do think that reading the introductions, there's like two by Marx and two by Engels at like, you know, at like 25 years out and like 35 years out. So they're really reflecting back on this text they wrote 25, 35 years ago. And then, you know, Marx dies and Engels talks about the grass growing around Marx's grave and credits Marx with coming up with historical materialism and talks about in the intro how, you know, Engels was moving in this direction, he says, you know, like the conditions of the working class in England, for example, he cites as like his attempt to move his own thought in this direction toward historical materialism. But it was really upon reuniting with Marx that Marx laid it out in very simplistic terms that Engels immediately understood and immediately sort of culminated his already existing thought. And then that's when they came together to write this book. So just Engels giving credit to Marx for the core of the idea is kind of cool and interesting. But he also says something in one of the intros, I think it's the preface to the English edition of 1888, where he said he sort of quickly summarizes Marx's elucidation of historical materialism. And then he says, this proposition that, in my opinion, is destined to do for history what Darwin's theory has done for biology, we, both of us, had been gradually approaching for some years before 1845. And understanding historical materialism through an analogy to Darwinian evolution via natural selection can be really helpful in understanding the scientific aspect of what we're doing here. Marx and Engels are doing and see themselves consciously as doing for history and society what Darwin did for biological life on planet Earth. And it's this evolutionary account. It's understanding the present state of things through an understanding of how they came to be through past transmutations and pressures existing on the outside and, you know, what the core of evolution is in biology versus what the core of evolution is in history and society, etc. So I was actually really interested in science and like the philosophy of science before I even really deeply dove into Marxism. And so my already existing interest in Darwin and evolution by natural selection was something that I used and picked up and ran with when it came to trying to understand Marxism as a science and specifically what Marx and Engels were trying to do with historical materialism. So I really love that analogy. I love that Engels makes it very explicit. And I actually love this little historical anecdote where Marx and Darwin wrote back and forth to one another. They were contemporaries. And Marx and Darwin actually had a little, like, I think just they each sent one letter to each other. I forget. I think it was in Love and Capital, the book Love and Capital, that people can go look and find that little historical anecdote. But it just is interesting that that actually happened. They were conscious of doing that and that they actually had correspondence with Darwin.
Yeah, and it's interesting too, because that's an analogy that Engels actually draws multiple times across his writing. So I believe his eulogy at Marx's grave also draws the comparison to Darwin. And obviously in a text that we talked about previously with socialism, utopian, and scientific, Engels talks about Darwin there as well in terms of dialectics, right? Because the explanation of dialectics that Engels is giving there is one that moves beyond sort of a static metaphysics and recognizes that change is sort of a constant process. And in that way, it's not just that sort of Marxism and evolutionary biology are both sort of scientific in the same sense, but both of them are kind of dialectical in a sense, because both of them recognize change occurring through struggle, through development, through external forces that act on beings, and that change being sort of the basic starting point for reality, not an aberration away from some static starting point. And so I do think it's really cool to see that comparison. I don't even think it's just an analogy. It's a sense in which both of them are making not just scientific discoveries, but also dialectical discoveries. And I think that's why it's Darwin in particular, of all the scientific innovators, that Engels seems to come back to over and over and over again when he's making that comparison to Marx.
Absolutely. And just pushing that dialectical point even further is like the inseparability of everything, the web of, like, even in the evolutionary context, the absolute web of life, and that animals and their attributes and plants, right, are literally constructed through their engagement with the rest of the natural world. And so to try to separate the bee from the environment in which it buzzes, you know, to try to separate the human from the society in which it operates, is always going to be a mistake and lead to wrong conclusions. And, you know, there's echoes of that in Buddhist philosophy, which people know I'm interested in as well. So just the way that Marxism, evolutionary biology, and some core insights from the Buddhist tradition all align in these different ways, but they all line up and are gesturing towards a similar understanding of the world, I think is very profound and has always been like a source of excitement for me when I'm engaging with any of this stuff.
Definitely.
Do you want to take it from here? Any other points you want to make?
Yeah, so one other thing that I think is interesting about this text is that Marx does a really interesting job of delineating communism in the Marxist sense from anti-capitalism more broadly. So I think this is one thing that is kind of interesting and that I think has some value today, right? Is I think we are living at a time where capitalism is obviously becoming a failure, right? Like, it's hard to look at the state of the world today and not see profound, unbelievable levels of crises, not only in the United States, but globally. You know, as we've hinted at before, the coronavirus pandemic has really pointed the way towards this. But in other countries, we've seen turns towards strong forms of reaction. And there clearly is a crisis within capitalism right now. And I think that as those kind of crises occur, it becomes very easy for people to criticize capitalism in sort of a reactionary manner, actually. And so one of the things that I think is interesting in this text is that Marx does some work delineating the difference between sort of reactionary socialism and sort of progressive Marxist socialism, right? And he points out that, you know, the old aristocracy at the end of feudalism had a reason to oppose capitalism, and they often vocally spoke like socialists in opposition to capitalism. But the thing that they wanted wasn't the development of workers' power into socialist future, but was to return to something before capitalism. And similarly, he points out that the petty bourgeoisie often sort of engage in socialist-y rhetoric against capitalism, but that this usually is reactionary in nature and wants to just control, you know, the economy for themselves rather than have the workers control. And I think that's really, really, really important and really insightful going, you know, from the time that Marx is writing, because a lot of that does explain sort of the rise of reactionary fascism, which often frames itself as a criticism of capitalism, right? You know, there's pictures that I was seeing from protests that were happening where there were Nazis that showed up that had shirts that said anti-capitalist and anti-communist on them, right? Oh my God, yeah. And I think that that really gets at this thing that Marx hints at in this text, which is that being anti-capitalist is not enough. Right? It's not just enough to dislike capitalism in rhetoric or in theory. We have to have something beyond capitalism, and that is power in the hands of the proletariat, in the hands of the working class. And I think that as, you know, we move into further states of crises, we're going to see more people sort of pushing back against capitalism and saying, okay, yeah, I got to admit capitalism is bad. This thing is clearly not working very well, but we need to not build socialism, but some other thing. And I think in a sense, the way that Marx does that delineation work here to show that anti-capitalism is not the same thing as communism can really help us be careful about that rhetoric that I think we'll start to see emerge in a way that's very helpful.
Totally. And that just made me think of a classic sort of iconography on the, you know, specifically the anti-fascist left, which is sort of an interesting irony. You talk about fascists saying anti-capitalist and anti-communist. And I know I've pointed this out elsewhere, but the three downward facing arrows that you often see associated with anti-fascist work literally stand for anti-monarchism, anti-capitalism, and anti-communism. So in a lot of ways, it's fascinating and deeply ironic to see some versions of anti-fascism aligning perfectly in their rhetoric with the actual fascists who are saying we're anti-communist, anti-capitalist too, just like you. It really makes you think. And, you know, a lot of people wear that shit just with the intention of being generally anti-fascist, and they don't really, you know, do it to highlight their anti-communism. Right. But it's still worth thinking about and worth pointing out as at least an educational tool when it comes to explaining this to other people. But on the general front that you're advancing on, I like the part also when they're talking about different forms of socialism, and really this is just a form of liberalism, but they're calling it socialism. And they make clear, I think, in the intro that at the time they were operating, socialism was like acceptable as a term, and mm-hmm. a bunch of different people fell under that term, kind of like the way socialism is becoming so broadly sort of accepted in American society with like the Sanders sort of wing of socialist, but communist is still taboo. In that way, communist was inexorably tied up with the working class movement, whereas socialism in their context was tied up with sort of middle class reformers of all stripes. And so they go through several versions of it. And one of the versions is what they call bourgeois socialism, or we might call something like radical liberalism or left liberalism today. And they define it as a part of the bourgeoisie which is desirous of redressing social grievances in order to secure the continued existence of bourgeois society. And they go on to say, to this section belong economists, philanthropists, humanitarians, improvers of the conditions of a working class, organizers of charities, members of societies for the prevention of cruelty to animals, etc., etc. And he uses Proudhon's philosophy of misery as an example of this. But I think we can see this in our own society extremely well right now specifically. And I wrote this little piece out, and I'll just kind of read it really quickly.
Yeah, go.
But it says, you know, this includes virtually all liberal reformers and Democrats who wish to alleviate or lessen the worst contradictions and contestations in our society, precisely so that capitalist class society can continue. This is behind all their calls for civility, their funneling of BLM's revolutionary energy into symbolism instead of material change, and even their hatred of tepid reformers like Bernie. So much of the hate toward Trump by millionaires, wealthy Democrats, and never-Trump Republicans stems from the fact that Trump makes their system look bad, decreases support for it among the people, and delegitimizes its rule in the eyes of people domestically and abroad. They want a return to normal. They don't want a real alteration of the underlying conditions. They just want to treat the symptoms so they can continue amassing wealth, social status, power, etc. And then I continue a little bit and I say, ironically, Bernie is one of these people insofar as his policies would have actually strengthened and perpetuated capitalist class society by alleviating some of its most dramatic contradictions. But his reforms go too far for the liberal ruling elite. They begin to shift power away from the bourgeoisie and toward the proletariat, if only in relatively minor ways. And even that is unacceptable for the MSNBC liberals and rich politicians in the Democratic Party. It represents too much possibility for material change, and they want to keep change on the level of the symbolic, on the level of representation. So they ignored him, then they trashed him and slandered him, and then Obama worked behind the scenes to ensure he lost the primary, making centrists drop out and endorse Biden while convincing Warren to stay in and split the progressive vote, which she did. These liberals won't even accept tepid social democracy, so they are actually in a catch-22. They need to keep their system going via some serious reforms, but even mild social democracy is too radical for them to accept. They can't accept the reforms necessary to guarantee the continued existence of their system and their unjust role within it. So that really, that's what came to my mind when I read that passage about people who really do want to address social grievances and make the necessary reforms, but not to overthrow the system and bring in something better, but precisely so that they can preserve the system. And it behooves us to understand this amongst our midst and to help others understand this amongst our midst. And you're seeing this play out in a million different ways with the Black Lives Matter sort of slow but steady co-option by the liberal establishment and those on the liberal left. And so just something worth understanding, pointing out, and just connecting historically. This is in 1847, and we're still dealing with this exact shit as if some of these passages could be written about what we're going through today. And that, if nothing else, testifies to the analytical power of Marxism and historical materialism.
Right. And on top of that, it testifies to like how correctly, I think, Marx and Engels identified these contradictions in capitalism, because the fact that they still persist today does tell us to a certain extent that these are contradictions that are endemic to capitalist relations. And I think it's not just that this was like a particularly like visionary view of where things were going to go. This shows how much they understood the core instability within capitalism and liberal democratic rule that capitalism has sort of favored. And really, the fact that it still exists today does, in some ways, I think, vindicate the dialectical theory that they're putting forward here.
Totally. And just to say one more thing on that point, because it connects one of my points with what we just talked about, and I think you actually mentioned this too in your first go at this point. In the text, it says, And they do this argument, and then they say, and here it becomes evident that the bourgeoisie is unfit any longer to be the ruling class in society and to impose its conditions of existence upon society as an overriding law. Society can no longer live under this bourgeoisie. In other words, its existence is no longer compatible with society. And that was written in 1847, and here we are in 2020, surrounded by pandemics, by climate change, by the rise of fascism, by just the utter incompetence and inability for the ruling class to move past and understand this moment so they can meaningfully address it. And in a lot of ways, they proved it back then, and they're still proving it today. They're unfit to rule society, and more than being unfit, they're now actually moving into the realm of confronting us with an existential threat. Their continued rule over us in the globe is not just theoretically or morally unjust. It's actually a threat to life on Earth at this point.
Right.
And so we need to move beyond this. We need to push beyond the boundaries of bourgeois society and deconstruct class society and dismantle it and move forward into the future, or literally life on this planet as we know it is threatened. And that is just, that's something worth thinking about. And again, testifies to the foresight and the vision and the understanding that Marx and Engels had back then.
Yeah. I don't know if I can add much more than that. I think it's a pretty dramatic note to finish that off.
For sure.
Those were kind of the main things that I had, unless you have something else.
Yeah, I have a question I'll toss your way,
cool.
And I'm really interested in your thought on this, because I really do struggle with this, and I've not read Engels' text on the family, even in this text, I get the general gist of what they're saying, but perhaps this is just my own ignorance, but they have a critique of the family, and they talk about how the family manifests under capitalism, how that's compared to how capitalists think of the family under capitalism, and then what the communist approach to the family might be. And it's sort of one that's very skeptical of the family unit, etc. Do you have any thoughts on that? Have you read that original text by Engels that might flesh that out for me?
Yeah, so I've read some of Engels on it, and I've also read sort of Kollontai's thoughts on the family, which build on Engels and Marx a lot. So I wrote an article in this fairly recently for Cosmonaut, actually, called The Family is Dead, Long Live the Family.
Cool.
And kind of my perspective on the treatment of the family in this text is that Marx, one, is not doing enough work here. It's very vague, and that's why I think those other sources are necessary. But I think that my takeaway from this text is that Marx isn't necessarily saying, like, communists want to come in and destroy the family. He definitely thinks communists are opposed to the family. But I think if you read that section carefully, what he's really saying is capitalism has already destroyed the family, right? So one thing that Marx notes is that on the one hand, capitalism has kind of created this image of, like, the bourgeois family unit, and simultaneously made that impossible for the vast majority of the population. So on the one hand, the bourgeois family becomes the ideal we should all strive to, but at the time that Marx is writing, many children are laborers, women and husbands are laborers. The entire sort of system of the family has been destroyed through proletarianization, and the family units that once existed, you know, prior to capitalism are gone. And so I think what Marx is describing there largely is the destruction of the family by capitalism. And then he says, well, the capitalists, they come and say, oh, the communists are opposed to the family, as sort of some scaremongering technique. And what Marx is saying is they have no leg to stand on, because it's them who have created the conditions by which the family is being abolished, you know? So I think that that is largely what, how I would read that. In my article that I wrote, I kind of argue that we should back off the language of family abolition a little bit, because I think that it is a little propagandistically unwise. It just does not sound good to the kind of people that we want to recruit. And I like how Kollontai talks about it in her work, where she says, yes, capitalism has destroyed the family. She's writing in the context of Russia, and she says the Russian family has been largely destroyed, but we can't just try to recreate that family. What we need to do is re-envision the meaning of family as a great proletarian family. So the way that I kind of like to think about it, at least, is not like, oh, we're getting rid of the family, but as capitalism has destroyed the family, essentially. So what will replace it? And what will replace it is the class as a family. And that's kind of how I've approached it. And you definitely have to go beyond Marx to get some of those insights here. But I think that that is still can fit with what Marx is saying in this text.
So a way to summarize that perhaps is a socialist or communist understanding of the family under capitalism is that it's largely been devastated by capitalist sort of class relations and the commodification of everything. And as and capitalist society wants to break the family down into basically a discrete economic unit, where perhaps some of the injustices and hierarchies of the broader capitalist society get instantiated, right? They talk about sort of the rule of parents over kids in some extent. But then what you're saying is that the communist view of the family is, as we change the social conditions, the underlying material conditions, that the our conception of family is not that we destroy it, and what that even means, who knows, but that it's actually an extension of our family beyond just the little you know, the two parents and the 2.5 children or whatever, but to include and be really embedded in a broader community. And maybe one way this cashes out is a more communal understanding of childcare, especially in a socialist transition. I think taking some of the pressure and the burdens on working families surrounding childcare and taking care of their kid and really being solely responsible but never compensated for the raising of those children, that will be expanded under a socialist or even a communist society. And so family will still be there. You'll still have your close family. How could you not? But that would be extended into the community more broadly, and it would represent a true advance of the concept and the actual basis of what a family is, right?
Exactly. And for Kollontai especially, it would be the socialization of a lot of women's labor, right? So one thing that she talks about at the period she's writing, and she says, look, capitalism has already socialized some of that labor. So traditionally, part of a woman's job as part of the family structure was to cook and feed her for her family. But hasn't the existence of restaurants kind of even disrupted that? She says, now, if you have enough money, you don't ever have to cook as a woman for your family anymore. But the thing is, your access to that is your class. It's the ability to have the money in order to take advantage of that socialization of labor. Or, you know, rich women are able to hire servants, for example, which in its own way is sort of a socialization of that labor. But the thing is that it is socialized for the class at the expense of another class. And so part of what the abolition of the family and the expansion to the proletarian family would be an equitable, egalitarian, classless socialization of women's labor as well.
I see. Thank you for that. I appreciate that articulation. It really does help me understand what has for a long time been sort of one of the most confusing aspects, and something which is really a part of my own, just my own failure to do the readings and engage in that text. So I appreciate that. And I actually will, right after this, go read your article. I didn't know that you put that out in Cosmonaut. So that's awesome.
Totally. Yeah. Happy to give some insight on that.
All right. Well, do you have any other, I think I covered all my main points. Do you have anything you want to say before we close?
It's basically everything I had. I hope, you know, that people enjoy this text. Again, it's a classic, so let's try to wrestle with it and make sense of it. And hopefully this will be helpful in doing that.
Absolutely. All right. You want to take us out? And we'll, I guess I'll just mention that next month we're going back to current events. We don't know what we'll read after that, but on our next episode, we'll announce the reading to follow. But next month will be a return to current events, and there are plenty to discuss.
Yeah, we'll definitely have a very, very full episode next month. So thank you all for your support. Thank you for checking in and, you know, always listening to our episodes. It means a lot to us. We really are trying to provide resources that are helpful for people in furthering their political development, and having listeners at all always is just a fantastic thing. So thank you for your support. You can check us out on social media, on Twitter at Red Menace Pod, and also on Patreon at Patreon/TheRedMenace, I believe is what it is. And you can support us there if you want. We release extra episodes every month that kind of get into additional content or Q's and A's or sometimes early releases. It kind of varies and depends. So yeah, go ahead and check those things out. Thank you so much for your continued support, and we look forward to, you know, being able to dialogue with you all and give more information next month as we dive back into current affairs.